Rochester's urban-suburban program has been receiving a lot of attention over the past few months. For one, it's celebrating its 50th anniversary this year. In fact, it's the oldest voluntary interdistrict transfer program in the country. Its purpose, to put an end to racial imbalance in public schools in Monroe County. We've covered this program before on Need to Know, and the fact that New York State has the most segregated schools in the nation. Out of the nearly 20 suburban districts that could incorporate the program, currently 7 are participating in urban suburban. But others are considering taking it on ahead of the 50th anniversary. Districts like Spencerport. But as you may have heard in the news media, not all community members are on board with the idea. Here's a look at the varied perspectives from the most recent public hearing in Spencerport.
I feel people are split. People just don't know. There are some people that are really passionate about this both ways.
Well, I think any change or anything is going to make people be nervous.
My concern here is not to state a position for or against urban suburban. My concern right here is to question whether the board can really represent this community when none of you campaigned on urban suburban. Nobody in this room have a chance to vote for any of you to be put where you are based on your standings for this. I don't care about my standing. I'll go with whichever way this community goes as a majority. Put it to a vote and let them decide.
Well, I think it gives our kids an opportunity to be exposed to things they wouldn't normally be exposed to in their own village. Just different ethnic backgrounds, different relationships, friendships.
Our son and daughter who have graduated still maintain relationships with students from the city. Some of the colleges you saw up there, Ohio State and Harvard, that's where their friends went. Our youngest daughter is a freshman. She actually has 2 friends that are in the urban suburban program.
She doesn't know that.
She has no idea. But we know. And it's irrelevant. It really was irrelevant to our kids because of the relationships that they established with kids. It had nothing to do with where they lived. It had to do with establishing relationships with people.
I'm not happy with this program. I'm also not happy that we can't seem to come up with some sort of equitable solution to being able to help people in this program without excluding other people. I'm talking about excluding Caucasians from this program. There's no reason that you should exclude those people from the city school district as well. My daughter asked me why our school district was in the news so much lately. I told her it's because the district is examining urban suburban. I asked her if she knew what that was. She said yes, it was to allow city kids to come to our school. I said, how does that make you feel? She said, it makes me happy that I could do good things for other kids. I said, I agree. She then said, so anyone from the school can come here? I said, no, our school district gets to choose who comes from a list of minorities based on academics and attendance. She said, what's a minority? I said, according to the state of New York, it is someone who's Black, Asian, Hispanic, or Native American. So only minorities get to come here? As a puzzled look came over her face. I said, that's correct. I asked, how does that make you feel? She said, it's not fair. We learned in school, Dr. Martin Luther King said, all people should be treated equally, not excluding any one group.
Amazing, even an 8-year-old can tell it's racist.
China is the largest economy in the world. And soon as we saw in the PowerPoint, in the coming years, ethnic minorities, Blacks, Hispanics, Asians, will be the majority in our country. And ultimately, unfortunately, Kodak and Xerox and Bausch & Lomb simply are not the companies that they used to be. So what that means for students everywhere, and what that means for students here in Spencerport, is that ultimately they're going to have to deal with people who don't look like them, and they may have to go other places to explore the opportunities that they want for their careers and for their lives. When they go to college, when they go into their professional careers, there are going to be people who do not look like them, and it's going to be extremely important for them to have some kind of understanding, some kind of comfort with dealing with people who don't look like them.
Let's take a closer look at the urban-suburban issue in Spencerport and on a larger scale. To do that, I'm joined by Mike Crumb, superintendent of the Spencerport Central School District, Jessica Lewis, communication specialist for the urban-suburban program, and Quinisha Anderson, a graduate and alum of urban-suburban, and also the president of the program's alumni board. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
So, Mike, just to begin, I understand you worked in other Rochester area districts that have the urban-suburban program, and I want to know when you first thought to yourself, this could be a good fit for Spencerport, this program. Let's see what we can do to make it a reality. Did you ever imagine the outcry? Did you ever imagine that it would become an issue of contention?
No, I never really thought it would become a contentious issue. You know, having worked in West Rondequoit for 11 years, back in the late 80s, early 90s, it was a seamless program that existed. The culture, the children were all part of the student body. So as I looked, as superintendent in Spencerport, about the attributes of West Rondequoit, an excellent school district in our district, I didn't see where we were different. I easily felt we could go and we can apply this program and it would be successful. You know, as I thought about it, and again getting to the concern that some of our community members have, we come from a position of commonality. Our community values the education that we provide to our children. And we heard that quite a bit the other night. Again, people really appreciate the excellent educational programs. And they do wonder, why is it necessary to participate in the urban-suburban program? Well, quite honestly, one of the things that I keep thinking about is that when a child graduates from our school and they leave the blue and gold border of Spencerport, they're going to go to a more diverse next chapter of their life, whether it be college, the workforce, or the military. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation did some research back in 2012 and actually found that at colleges, universities offering a post-secondary degree, 40% of the students were minorities. Spencerport has a minority rate of about 14% as identified by the State Education Department in 2012-2013. If I look at the active military, 25% made up of minorities. So as I think about the holistic development that we need to do for our students to prepare them for their futures, I thought this would be a beautiful program, going on my experience in West Rondequoit, but also thinking about the futures that they will be going to.
Quinisha, you're the president of the Alumni Association with Urban Suburban. I understand there was a point in the past several weeks after the first two Spencerport public hearings when some of the members, some of the former alumni, they got together and they questioned after the reaction of community members whether Spencerport was in fact a good fit for the Urban Suburban program. And I just want you to tell me a little bit about the logic behind that and also how it worked itself out.
Well, I think a lot of times how this program is presented is as if it's an entitlement or a handout to a group of impoverished, unsafe black students, and that all those statements are not entirely correct. So as folks that have graduated from the program, we have a sense of pride of the effort that it took for us to earn our education, things like that. So we see it very different. So when school boards come or approach us about coming on, we see it as a mutual helping of both sides. So as the alumni, we feel that we have a choice in saying this is a good decision for students that are coming into this program or not. As in, is this a safe environment? Is this community ready? Will they benefit, as in will our students benefit from being there, or will they be targeted by something? Initially, with all the outcry or disrespect and things of that nature, we did not feel that. So Mike Crumb was so gracious to allow us to come in and speak with him and the school board. And that's when we realized that the folks that were making all the noise were not a complete representation of the actual community. And it felt good to be heard, for us to present it to them a different way than they probably had experienced it. And so they heard us, we heard them. And then when I went to this most recent meeting, it was just kind of the same scenario. The folks that are yelling in the back, being extremely disrespectful, did not actually outnumber the amount of people who are actually on board for this program. So it's kind of amazing that these people are literally yelling, but they're actually the minority of this community. And so the people that are the ambassadors for this community are a far greater representation of Spencerport than the folks that are yelling from the back. And it's tough to kind of see through that because the people in the back are yelling so loud and aggressively, even at their own community members.
So I think that's the way in which it's kind of worked itself out, is that we were able to get past the noise and get to the heart of the issue, which is that Spencerport is represented by folks like Mike Crumb. Yeah.
Jessica, I want to tie you into this. I should also point out you're also a graduate of the Urban-Suburban program, and there's been a big push on the end of Monroe One BOCES and Urban-Suburban ahead of the 50th anniversary to get more districts to participate. And I want to know, is it a tough sell? Because I heard individuals speaking out at the public hearing on Tuesday, and they said in so many words, there's really nothing to sell when something is successful. So what makes Urban-Suburban successful, and how do you define its success, and how do you present that to districts and to community members?
Sure. It's not a sell at all. Because we have such a wonderful reputation in this community, it has 50 years of success. And so I think that the suburban districts realize that it's mutually beneficial. It's beneficial for the students of color who participate, but it's beneficial for the residents who live in the suburban districts to interact with, to get to know, to experience what life is like for other children. And so when other districts consider participation, it's something that we welcome. Each year we receive a number of applications from students who live in the city of Rochester who want to participate in the program. And so with growth and expansion on the horizon, it gives more students an opportunity who live in the city, not necessarily they don't have to be RCSD students, but who live in the city, the opportunity to interact with our neighbors who live in our suburban districts.
Well, I want to know, Mike, I know if the board approves the Urban-Suburban program, Spencerport, we're talking about approximately 18 students. Is that right for the 2015-16 school year that would be admitted through Urban-Suburban?
That is correct. For the 15-16 school year, the plan that I would have would be to bring forward 6 students at first grade, 6 at second, and 6 at sixth grade.
And I want to talk to me about the number, because I know you mentioned this, and I've covered this before. Districts, their enrollment is declining, and we can see that, and they're not at capacity. Mm-hmm. And so in terms of relationship building and exposure to other cultures, I want to know, would that number grow through time? Because it seems so small that the kids would be scattered throughout, and that that opportunity wouldn't be there necessarily to connect and to grow as much as some may hope.
As I've looked at the other participating districts in the Urban-Suburban program, notably West Irondequoit and Pittsford, who have been some of the founding members of that, they have a much larger participation in Urban-Suburban, but I also recognize they've had many years to refine their practices. I do believe that for us, if we have the opportunity to implement this program, it would be wise to start with about 6 to 8 students per year, you know, maybe maximum of 70, 75 when fully implemented, so that we can learn about the program. Because the piece that's a non-negotiable for me, there are two elements. One of them, I take great pride in having low class sizes at our school, and that leads to the other non-negotiable. We want to make sure that whatever we implement, it is going to be beneficial to the student's success. Because that is a non-negotiable for me, and it's a non-negotiable for the community, as it should be. We do have an excellent reputation, and I think that this would only go and enhance the holistic education we provide to our children.
I want to talk about something that some parents and community members spoke about, and we'll play the other side here. We heard this at the public hearing, and there were harsh words in terms of this being about race and the media making this about race. And some even suggested, we heard this in the clip, that the Urban-Suburban program was racist because they weren't allowing Caucasian students from the city to apply to the program. So in playing this other side, why not allow white students from the city to join? I know that Superintendent Vargas is meeting with leaders of Urban-Suburban to refine the mission statement, and instead of just focusing on racial isolation and reducing that, potentially expanding it to the concentration of poverty and also segregation of opportunity. So is that an option?
Well, I think that where this program is going to, it'll probably potentially be adjusted. But if in this moment right now we look at numbers and we talk about segregation on both sides of the equation, if the Rochester City School District is comprised 90% of minority students, and less so that's 10% of non-minorities, and we start to bus non-minorities out of the city school district, what are we doing for segregation or desegregation in the city school district? Further, if these suburban districts don't come on board to educate their students in a different environment, to take this number from 90% in the city school district, how are they helping the equation? So we can look at this program as in the Urban-Suburban program and say, it's racist, we don't allow white people in. Or we could look at these suburban districts and say, well, why aren't you pushing to have your students educated in a community that's different than theirs? We're looking at this the city students and saying, let's get them into a community so that this community can grow and, you know, flourish on a global scale. But how are we in turn looking into the city school district and saying, let's provide for them the same opportunity by bringing some of these folks in the suburbs into the city? That's something that we haven't talked about. So I think it's unfair to look at a program that is put in place to cultivate this global experience in the suburbs as a racist program and not look at the suburbs and say, well, maybe you're contributing to these racist situations by not coming into the city and being educated there.
Any other changes? You mentioned this could potentially change its mission. There could be a change with that. In terms of, we've got the 50th anniversary approaching. Jessica, looking forward, are there any changes, updates that could be made to the urban program moving forward?
There are some discussions that are occurring, but we have to look at the big picture and we have to look at all the implications from any changes that are, you know, being put on the table at this time.
And what do you think it will take? You know, all this being said, we've heard about the success of the program. You talked about, you know, we start small and potentially grow, new opportunities looking forward. What do you think is the cause of concern among folks in Spencerport and other communities when it comes to adopting this program? And I'd like the perspective of all of you.
Well, I'll offer my perspective up front. I really think it's just angst of something new. All of us respond to change in different ways. And while we can look at the 7 participating school districts in Monroe County who have had great success with this program, this would be a new initiative in Spencerport. And as I mentioned before, people take great pride in the schools and the education their children receive. So I think without them fully understanding how it would actually be applied and implemented, I think they just have concerns for something that they value deeply.
Yeah, I think I can agree with the change element. There's fear. One thing, after having a little bit more time to digest the experience of the folks yelling in the back, it seems that one woman got up there and she spoke about how she works really hard. She works 3 jobs to ensure that her children can go to school in Spencerport because she wants this quality education for them. It almost feels as if folks feel a sense of privilege connected to their working, as if someone else working 3 jobs in the city shouldn't have the same experience, or working in Fairport or elsewhere. So I think it's fear, but I also think there is a sense of wanting to maintain their community in the way that it is and not wanting it to look any different.
I also think that there are some misperceptions and some broad brushstrokes being painted over folks who live in the city. People choose to live in the city because they want to. I'm a homeowner in the 19th Ward because I want to live in the city. I want my dollars to go into the city. And so not all people from the city are impoverished. All of our children are not low performing. All of our children are not, you know, misbehaving. And I think because of the misperceptions that people have, there's concern, which then turns into angst or fear, and then the idea that, you know, we don't want these people coming into our district. You know, people from the city, if you will, are flourishing and are doing wonderful things and can contribute positively to any district wherever they may choose to go to school.
Mike, talk to me about what's next in Spencerport. I understand that there's a meeting taking place, a board meeting later this month. What can we expect?
I will be finalizing my recommendation that I will be making to the Board of Education for their consideration and discussion on Tuesday, February 24th at a meeting that will be held in our middle school auditorium at 7 p.m. The board will have discussion and they will be making a decision one way or the other regarding the direction of urban suburban and my recommendation to implement in the fall of 15-16.
So it will come down to a board vote. I know some community members are speaking out saying, why can't the community chime in? But this will solely come down to a board decision.
That is the way that is being spoken by the Board of Education at this point. If we think about the role of a Board of Education in a school district, they are elected by the community to provide oversight for the school district. They make decisions all the time about instructional programs, operational initiatives, the budget. They're elected to do that, and at this point they feel that that is their responsibility to truly make sure I provide them with a thorough recommendation with details for them to consider.
And Jessica, I understand in terms of districts that are interested, Hilton is one that's considering learning more about the urban suburban program. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Well, more to learn about, and we'll stay tuned to Spencerport to see how everything unravels. So we thank you so much, Quinisha Anderson, Jessica Lewis, and Mike Crumb. I appreciate your time and also for your perspectives on this issue. And we will have continuing coverage of the urban suburban interdistrict transfer program as it prepares to celebrate its 50th anniversary this June. And as always, we'd like to hear your thoughts and your questions. So join the conversation on Twitter at hashtag NTKWXXI.